In this video, we're going to be talking about the basis for a topology. This is a very important concept in topology, so it's essential that we understand it correctly. So let's jump right into the definition. As always, we have some set X, and we say that a basis on a topology is going to be a collection B of subsets of X. So then B is going to be a subset of parts of X that satisfies these two properties. Every time we have one element x in the set, there exists one set B in the basis that contains x. So we can write this more shortly as there exists B in our basis such that B contains x. And when we have x in the intersection of two elements that are in the basis, there exists another element in the basis such that X is an element of P3 and it's contained in the intersection. So basically, if we have here P1 and P2 and we take some element X in there, then there always exists a smaller element B3 that is also in our basis. So this gives us some sort of density for our basis, because we can see that we can always go deeper and deeper. And what happens if I have a collection that satisfies these two properties? So let's say that I found a collection B that satisfies... Well, it's kind of like I have all these sets, so I already have all the complicated part of my set. So can I generate a topology from these sets? Well, we can. And what we do is we can define a topology T that is going to be all the subsets of X such that for every X that's an element in U, there exists some B in our basis B such that X is an element of this set B and B is a subset of U. So essentially what I'm saying is I have some set U and an element X. If I can find some element B that is in our basis, then this set U is going to be a part of my topology. Well, I'm saying that this is a topology, but let's actually prove it. So from the last video, we know we have to prove three things to say that some set is a topology. The first one was saying that the empty set and X were part of that topology. So we have to see that if the empty set is here. Well, yes, because when I start this sentence, for every X in the empty set, then whatever comes after that is going to be true, trivially. So this is correct, it happens. Now, is X in my topology? Well, let's grab some element X in X and prove that there exists some B in our basis such that this happens. But now, when we look at B, we said B satisfies 1 and 2. So it's satisfying these two properties. And so we have, in number one, for each x in x, there exists b that contains x. So trivially, there exists b that contains x, and it's obviously contained in x. So given x in x, property one gives us the existence of b in the basis b such that X is contained in B, which is obviously contained in X. So great, X is an element in our topology. And with this, we finish proving the first property. Now we have to prove that arbitrary unions are in our topology. So if I grab an arbitrary collection of elements in my topology, I want to prove that the union of all these sets is also in my topology. So how do I prove that the union is in my topology? Well, let's go to the definition. Now, instead of reading U, I'm going to say the union. So the union of all these sets is in the topology if for every x in the union, there exists an element in the basis such that x is an element of that P and is a subset of the union. So we have to grab x in the union of all these sets. Now x is in the union, so there is some alpha such that x is an element of U alpha. Because x is in the union of many sets, then it is in at least one of them. And because U alpha is an element in the topology, then we know that there exists some set B in our basis such that x is an element of B, which is a subset of U alpha. But U alpha is a subset of the union of all this. So I actually found a set in my basis such that this happens, and this is exactly what had to happen for the union to be in my topology. So we have that the union of all these sets is in our topology, and with this we have proven the second property for a topology, and the third one was the finite intersections. So what I'm gonna do here is actually prove it for just two, and I will leave you to prove the rest by induction. So to prove that the intersection is in the topology, let's grab an element in the intersection. We want to find an element in the basis such that x is an element of U of P and B a subset of the intersection. Now x is in the intersection of U1 and U2. So this gives us two things. Well, obviously x is in U1 and x is in U2. But these two were elements in the topology. Then we know that there exists B1 such that x is an element of B1 contained in U1. And because U2 is also an element in the topology, then there exists B2, this in our basis, such that X is contained in B2, subset of U2. So from this, X is in B1, X is in B2, we have that X is in the intersection of P1 and P2. But this intersection may not be in the topology. Doesn't matter, because we have the second property that we haven't used so far. We used the first one to prove that X was an element in the topology, but the second one, well, it says exactly what we need. We have an element in the intersection of two elements in our basis, so there exists a third element in the basis such that we have these inclusions. So let's write that down. X is in the intersection of P1 and P2, so then, because of property number 2, there exists B3 in our basis such that X is contained, is an element in B3. B3 is contained in B1 intersection B2. But now B1 intersection B2 is obviously a subset of U1 intersection U2. So what we have is we found B3 such that X is an element of B3, subset of U1 intersection U2. And this is exactly what we had to prove in order to say that U1 intersection U2 is an element on our topology. So now that we have proven the three properties, we can actually say that this is a topology. And we are actually going to call it the topology generated by the basis B. Let's finish talking about basis with a lemma. This lemma will be very useful whenever we have two topologies and we want to know what is the comparison between them. We have two bases, B and B prime, that are bases of tau and tau prime respectively. So that is, tau and tau prime are generated by B and B prime. And so we have the following equivalence. Tau prime is finer than tau. So this, if you recall from our previous video, means that tau is a subset of tau prime, and for each x in our set and each basis element that contains x, there is a basis element in B prime such that we have this inclusion. So let's see what this is actually telling us. Let's say we have some element x. This tells us that every time that I grab some B in our basis B that contains x, there exists a basis element for the other basis, for the other topology, such that this happens. We have x contained in that other element that is a subset of B. The rest of this video is going to be the proof for this lemma. So if you don't want to see it, just skip to the next one. Let me remind you before you go that we have amazing perks and merchandise in our Patreon page. You can also get several topology books with the links in the description of the video to further support the channel. Let's jump right into the proof. So we want to prove an equivalence. That is, we have to see that 1 implies 2 and 2 implies 1. Let's first prove that 2 implies 1. So what we want to see is that tau is contained in tau prime. So given u in tau, we want to prove that u is also an element in tau prime. And our hypothesis is that this thing happens. So let's take an element in u. Now, because u is an element in our topology tau, and tau is generated by the basis B, then we know that there exists an element B in the basis such that X is an element of B contained in U. Basically, we have U. We took an element X and we were able to find some basis element B. But now property 2 tells us that when we have some element in our basis that contains X, there is an element in the other basis for which this happens. So we actually found, we know the existence of B prime such that this happens. We now found B prime here. And then this one we said was contained in U. So given U in our topology and given some element X in U, we found an element in the other basis, B prime, such that X is contained in B prime, contained in U. But this was the definition that you had to satisfy for it to be an element in tau prime. So this tells us that U is also an element in tau prime. And so we have what we wanted to prove, that was tau is a subset of tau prime. Now let's see that 1 implies 2. That is, if we know that tau prime is finer than tau, then this property is valid. So we have to prove that for each x and each basis element in B that contains it, there exists another one such that this happens. So let's take an element x in x and B in our basis such that contains x. Well, obviously, B is an element in our topology T because the basis B generated tau, and so it contains all the elements in the basis. And because tau is finer than tau prime, then B is also an element in tau prime. And because it's an element in tau prime, then there exists B prime in the other basis, because this B prime is the one that generates the tau prime topology, such that X is an element in B prime contained in B. This is the definition of the topology generated by a basis. And that's it. This is exactly what we wanted to prove here. So with this, we finished the theorem and we also finished the video.